Cryptocurrency. It's a fad. It's a bubble. It's the future. If there is anything that is certain about cryptocurrency and the blockchain, it's that it is very confusing for both business and consumers alike. For Tech Republic and ZDNet, my name is Dan Patterson, and we're speaking today with Jeff McCabe, the co-founder and CEO, and Tim Sanders, chief marketing officer of the Divvy Project. Their goal is to make cryptocurrency and the blockchain a lot more accessible and understandable. Gentlemen, thank you very much for your time today. First, I wonder if you could enumerate some of the problems of cryptocurrency right now.
Well, basically, I mean, the first problem is that the minute people start trying to do it, they get confused by all the jargon and they get confused by the entire sort of just everything. Everything is new and different. For example, they call it a wallet that you put your cryptocurrency in, but actually people are immediately confused because there are coins, their cryptocurrency is not actually inside the wallet. So the very name that people use starts to confuse people from the first step. So basically we made a list of all of these things that confused us in the beginning and have confused our friends and family and everybody else. And we're addressing every one of them.
So think about it this way. Cryptocurrency, and I'm quoting you on this, bro, created by geeks for geeks. You know, it's like if you wanted to set up a masternode so that you could earn coins, you'd better have hacker-level patience because it's going to take you hours and hours on that side of the coin. And if you want to send or spend money right now in cryptocurrency, it's crazy. I mean, if I wanted to send you money, you'd have to send me this like massive hex key, maybe a QR code, et cetera. It's not PayPal easy. And we think that's really inhibiting mainstream adoption. Right now, there's a lot of FOMO, but really where the tipping point is going to happen on this is somebody's going to take a total design UX approach to cryptocurrency. And we think that's going to be the preferred brand.
I think that that is, all of those observations are dead on. But before we get into some of the solutions, I wonder if we could kind of bust some FUD around cryptocurrency. It is both a fad and it's the future. But why should, or to play devil's advocate, why should we believe in cryptocurrency as the future? Why do we care?
Okay. He's going to have an elegant answer. Let me tell you, as an old guy who's been through these wars, I've seen it. I've seen the fads. I was one of the first 100 employees at Southwestern Bell Mobile when they launched cell phones in the 80s. You talk about a fad. They were predicting 10% user adoption by the year 2000. That's how much of a fad they thought it was. They were wrong. I joined the Internet Revolution in 97 and worked for Mark Cuban. Everybody said e-commerce is a fad. Video streaming was a fad. They were wrong. And most recently, and this is the great analogy here, cloud. I'm telling you, until about 2012, cloud was a fad. IT hated the idea of going off-premise, but the same reason people are afraid of crypto, and that is accessibility and security. So Jeff will talk a little bit about why crypto is something that is actually very, very fungible, very usable form of currency.
Yes, well, the way I see it, everything in the world is going digital. So, you know, it started with music and now movies, and money is one of those things that hasn't really changed in thousands of years, actually, since paper money was invented. Now, banks have controlled things for a long time, and now they've basically not allowed the public to use money, use their own money. It's actually illegal. They put you in jail. So cryptocurrencies have come along, and they're changing the paradigm. And so right now, there's a little bit of friction between the two sides. Eventually, the banks and the governments will sort of get on this because the technology of blockchain is so powerful and amazing that it sort of can't be denied. And we're seeing a lot of struggle between governments around the world trying to decide what they should do and how they can implement this or whether they should block it. It's one of these things that can't be stopped because it's just it's too powerful. And companies and countries that adopt blockchain are going to find that they're outcompeting those that don't. So
yeah, think about it this way. Think about what social media like Facebook did to decentralized publishing. And you can't undo the Facebook effect now, right? People are their own publishers. Cryptocurrency decentralizes money the same way social media decentralized publishing. We all become currency owners, currency creators, if you will. So as Nicholas Negroponte said in his famous book, Being Digital, that which can be digitized will be digitized.
Okay, so I think generally I probably agree with you, and I love those technology examples of things that were predicted to be fads and became monster trends. But as we know, the road of technology is also littered with a bunch of things that were supposed to be fads and ended up being fads. So what are the technological underpinnings? What are the reasons that are inherent to cryptocurrency and the blockchain that will help it avoid this the road of fad death?
Well, it's a complicated problem, and the answer is complicated too, because it depends on what you're talking about. And since we have a very short time, it's hard to really explain that clearly. In fact,
extrapolate, it's all good.
Cryptocurrency is complicated, and the weird thing about it is the more clearly you explain it, the more confused people actually get about it, because it's so technical. So, I mean, in a short answer, basically, the way I see it, technology has a way of sort of making things more diverse, giving people more options, opening up all kinds of new opportunities, and that hasn't been done with money yet, and that's what cryptocurrency is doing. It's, you know, thousands and thousands of really smart people, really creative people all over the world that are coming up with all these great ideas to make money more fun and interesting, socializing it. That's what we're trying to do, is try to make it more social and warm. And, you know, we compare it to PayPal or internet banking, but actually what we're doing is a lot more interesting than that, and a lot more social, a lot warmer, and a lot more interactive than anything that's been developed before.
Let me give you another way to think about that too. So I agree with you. There have been things that, like Pointcast, remember Pointcast with push technology, it was completely a fad. The reason it's a fad is not because the users didn't want to use it, it's because talent didn't gravitate to it. When you look at things like e-commerce, like cloud that caught on, the talent went there first and the money went there second. So I got a buddy that worked with me at Yahoo, Gary Garlinghouse. He's a communications executive. He wrote the Peanut Butter Manifesto that was leaked to the Wall Street Journal. He's a great operator. He went to YouSendIt. Remember YouSendIt before Dropbox? Guess what? He's the CEO of Ripple. And I'm telling you, top talent is moving to crypto, and they're moving from all kinds of spaces. We saw this with cloud a few years ago, where all the talent in IT bugged out and moved straight to cloud, AWS, IBM Cloud, Oracle Cloud, SAP Cloud. And I really think when I look at trends and try to look at ones that are mega trends, I ask myself the question, did smart people burn their boats and join this? Because if they don't, it's going to die.
Of course, smart people like AR, a lot of things. Smart people do a lot of things that the mainstream, that mass market consumer adoption, let alone business adoption, just doesn't buy into. And I don't know that I buy the argument that a currency needs to be warm and fuzzy. The dollar is not warm and fuzzy, but it is accessible. And that's kind of the key to what you guys are doing. I think that's what's really important here. So tell me what's not accessible about crypto now, and how are you changing that?
Well, right now, basically, Bitcoin could have a lot of advantages, you know, but it's been made, a lot of those advantages that were imagined by the creators, by Satoshi, have been taken away because of the conflicts that are part of the system. Basically, Bitcoin now, it takes more than 20 minutes to send a transaction, and it's too expensive to be used to buy a hamburger. So those are two problems we're solving right away. And it's already been solved, but Bitcoin kind of gets all the press. So what we're doing is basically trying to improve all of these different things. So, I mean,
a big secret to that is the governance system. I think the governance system we're building now is vastly superior to how Bitcoin's doing it, because that's why you have hard forks. I mean, talk a little bit about our approach to governance that enables all the UX innovations.
Yeah, so Bitcoin doesn't have a governance system. And so if they want to change Bitcoin, it becomes a huge public battle. In our case, we have a system of voting where people that own the coins can actually control the destiny of the coin, Divi coin, by changing some of the variables about how it operates. They can just take a vote, and however the vote goes, after some discussion within our system, without taking it public, people that actually own it, who have invested in it, get to decide that the future of it by changing certain variables. And the software will basically change the blockchain without a recode. So it can happen instantaneously.
I'll give you an example, a very specific thing we're changing. I mentioned before the masternode. So one of our early IPs is what we call the Mochi system, which is basically a one-click masternode install for dummies. Mm-hmm. I mean, if you wanted to set up a masternode and do POS mining, which you could use your computer for that, because it's not as, you know, POS is different than proof of work, it'd be your side hustle. It'd be like Lyft without, you know, your car. But you better be ready to spend 4 hours to 4 days to try to figure out how to set that masternode up. One of the first things we're shipping is a one-click masternode that my mother could set up on her desktop. And we really believe, much like how Uber made it stupid easy for you to have a side hustle with driving, or Airbnb made it dramatically easier than HomeAway to do apartment sharing, we're going to do the same thing on the back end of crypto. And then on the front end, of course, it's all about developing that smart wallet, where now when we launch our smart wallet, you'll be able to tell someone, you can send me money at diviproject.org/your name if it's not already taken. And you know that doesn't exist right now. And that's been a huge inhibitor of P2P sending, which drove the early growth of PayPal. We're going to go in and make that stupid easy right off the bat.
Jeff McCabe, Tim Sanders, the DV Project, Divi Project, thank you very much for your time today. I wish we had hours and hours to talk. The next time you're in New York City, we will do that. Until then, this space is going to continue to evolve, not just the blockchain space, not just the cryptocurrency space, but the space you're in right now, which is creating the PayPal of a cryptocurrency. So I wonder if you could look into the future for me. Give me 6 months, 12 months, 18 months down the road. Where is the market?
Well, that's a good question. I can tell you very clearly. There's a technology called atomic swaps that basically allows any cryptocurrency to be changed for any other if they're participating in that system. And that creates an amazing ecosystem for cryptocurrencies in general. Because normally in technology, one sort of big company will tend to dominate everything, the way Google monopolizes search and Facebook monopolizes social. Cryptocurrencies aren't going to be done that way. And people have asked me, like, what about competitors? And say, well, competitors don't really matter because if somebody wants to accept Bitcoin, but we can pay them in Divi because of atomic swaps. So that means that if all cryptocurrencies can be used interchangeably, then all of them can coexist. And if that's true, then basically people are going to choose ones that are easier and more fun to use. And so that's why we feel we have a huge sort of unfair competitive advantage with what
it's going to be a branded environment. Like we think maybe a year, 2 years from now, it's going to be like, as you say, Nike versus Adidas. It's not going to be what's in your wallet. It's like who made your wallet. And I think that's going to be the distinction when you have atomic swaps. So we talk about warm and fuzzy. What we mean is that we do a lot of community management. I mean, if you DM our community manager right now, he's going to be back with you in 10 to 20 minutes. We talk to everybody on Telegram. A lot of cryptos don't do that. And we do it not just to get better feedback for UX design and to get more incremental users. We do it to create affinity. So people want, and this is what we find out when we take a look at the Divi coins, people hold on to them. They want us to be successful, and scarcity drives the value that you create in this space. And so we think it's going to be a branded environment that's going to compete for relationships and not just be the next thing. Mm-hmm.